This is the Voice of Charleston Women podcast, where you can meet like-minded, strong, independent, professional, and inspiring local women. Connect, learn, grow. Let's all support each other as we rise together. This is Voice of Charleston Women.
Welcome to the Voice of Charleston Women podcast. I am your host, Erin Kinzel, and this is where we kind of get a chance to talk to the movers and shakers of Charleston, and we have so many amazing women locally. Today, it is my honor to welcome Kim Powell, who is one of those women, and she is the owner of Woodhouse Day Spa. Two locations, Mount Pleasant, a new location in downtown Charleston, and she is one heck of a business lady, and she's here to tell us about the spa and to also tell us her story of kind of second chapters in life. With that said, let me welcome Kim to the show. Kim, how are you?
I'm good. It's nice to be in 2021.
Right. This year's going to be a lot better, right?
It can't get worse. It probably could, but let's just pray to God the worst. I was just telling my managers, I said, what was I so stressed out about this time last year?
Because I would go back to that. We had no idea. I remember before COVID was even really a thing, you and I talking about it kind of lightly, like, have you heard about that thing happening? That's crazy. So anyway, things are improving for 2021. I just want to start for our listeners, for anyone locally who's been living under a rock and doesn't know what Woodhouse is, please tell me more about both of your spas and kind of what you offer for the community.
Sure. I'd love to. Well, thanks for having me. So in 2015, we opened the Woodhouse Day Spa in Mount Pleasant. I bought the former Zeus Seafood building and converted it into a 9,000 square foot luxury spa. Sits on 2.5 acres. It is a franchise. Woodhouse is a boutique franchise. And our model is sort of your Ritz-Carlton resort spa without the resort or resort prices. So we like to consider ourselves affordable luxury, a resort spa experience in your backyard. We're open 7 days a week. So that's really nice. And then we opened the second spa downtown Charleston at the new West Edge development, which is on the west side, which is where the new Publix grocery store is, close to the baseball field and the new Harbor Club. And for those people who, you know, in the hospitals. And it's a cool location. It's got two stories. It also is 9,000 square feet. So they're very similar in size, but not really in design because the downtown one is two stories and it does have more of a more unique city feel to it, I think. But anyway, those are the spas. And, you know, we just really pride ourselves in hospitality and making it very experiential.
Right. And I have to say, you haven't been doing this that long. When did you open Woodhouse in Mount Pleasant?
Yeah, we opened. So I moved to Charleston in June of 2014. Okay. I knew at that point I was going to open a Woodhouse Day Spa. I had, in February of 2014, just decided to buy, the rights to 12 locations in the Southeast, and my first one being in Charleston. So I kind of just dove in to this business head first, not really knowing what I was doing, and opened the first one in May of 2015. And then this one, of course, a year ago last week.
Yeah. So going on 6 years, you have accomplished so much with two locations. Everyone in town loves you. Everyone knows you. But what is so interesting is that this is something, as I mentioned in the beginning, this is kind of your second chapter. You had a whole life, a totally different career before this. You raised your children. You took some time off before you got into the world of spas. So just tell me, how does that happen that you totally changed trajectory?
Yeah, it is interesting. I'm actually writing a book about this. And so even in writing it, I'm asking myself how I did it. Because I think at some point, there's just that moment that you make that decision, kind of like you became an auctioneer. Like it's something that you just, it's like there's momentum building up. And I call it a tipping point. And people call that when the fear of staying the same is greater than the fear of changing, that is really what I think it always comes down to, you know, because we all like to stay the same as long as it's kind of comfortable. But then at some point, you just don't want to stay the same. Like you want that change, you just need it. And I really wanted to move to South Carolina. I really wanted to shift gears. I wanted to do something different. And then I loved spas and I love travel and I love hospitality. So I kind of just, once I sort of, I think because it was a franchise, it seemed a little more attainable to me because instead of just, I'm going to open a spa, which I knew nothing about, like having, I'm going to the Woodhouse in Dayton, Ohio. I know what this is. I could see myself doing this. It seems like they already have sort of like a roadmap to success. So I have to say, I'm not sure without the franchise model, I would have been, you know, so inclined, but I think it started with that little idea. And then that little idea just kind of kept building.
Right. So let's backtrack a little bit. What are you schooled in? What did you go to college for? Because it wasn't managing spas.
No, it was not. So my degree is in computer science. I went to Stetson University.
Mind blowing, because it's totally different. Did you work in computer science for a while?
I did. I went to school at Stetson University and then transferred to University of Dayton, received my bachelor's in 1991 in computer science and worked for IBM and LexisNexis before quitting to join my husband in the then painting company, which is now a 31-year-old industrial flooring company of which I'm a part owner as well. So I ended up sort of going from computers to construction to, you know, the spa business. But what I like to tell people is the computer science industry, for me at least, I like problem solving and I like metrics a lot. So even though it does seem kind of crazy because it isn't really spa related, it does help in business because I like to break things down into manageable little processes and I can look at something and say, all right, well, let's back up. If we had done this, then this, then this, would that process, you know, flow more smoothly? And so I kind of try to do that in the spa business.
Yeah, that makes sense. So kind of what happened in between when you had your boys, did you take time off or was there time when you were kind of a stay-at-home mom?
Not really. I started working when I was about 14 and did all sorts of
stuff. I'm not surprised by that because you're always on the go.
It's funny because my mom was a stay-at-home mom and my dad was an entrepreneur, owned a construction company. Okay. And my cousin's mom was very much a business person and their girls ended up being stay-at-home moms. So we kind of, my sister and I both have always just like enjoyed working. But I did pick the construction business and I started working 5 days a week, then four, then three, then two, and remotely as I raised my three boys, my three sons, So I will say as an entrepreneur, I kept on kind of molding my responsibilities so that I could also get the boys off to school, be there to pick them up after school. And then I'd go in from like 10 to 3 and do what I needed to do in the business, things like that.
Yeah. What advice do you have for someone? Because I think what you've done is one of the bravest things you can do to totally change trajectory, to move to a new city and then decide that you're going to open a new business and have so much success with that new business in just 5 years. I mean, what nuggets do you have for someone who's just kind of stagnant right now and might want to make a change?
Yeah. So I think, you know, look, part of it was just the fear of failure was so great when I moved here. I realized I had really taken on this major undertaking and then it like kept on growing. And I was like, oh my gosh, like I am risking like our entire savings here. Like I cannot fail. I cannot let my family down. So part of it is, you know, people would joke, you're always out there. You're always, you know, networking. Like it was really just because it was free to network. And, you know, like going to a bunch of things and talking to people was free and Facebook was free. So I was like, okay, I'm just going to do this so I don't fail, you know? So I think one is you've got to really hustle. I mean, there just isn't any shortcuts to success. I mean, it's a lot. I always say hard work always wins. And that doesn't mean that you can't ever slow down or it's never going to pay off to, you know, manage somebody else so you can have free time. But certainly at the onset, you've got to be willing to go. I mean, there were 20-hour days for the first year. I saw you.
You were all over town, hopping from event to event to event. You know, when we talk about marketing now, obviously there's so many digital options with Facebook ads and Google ads and all kinds of ways to market. But do you still feel that the old school way of just networking, going to those events as you did, talking to people face to face is truly what makes the difference?
Yeah. I mean, I think this, again, I'm not trying to plug my book that I haven't finished, but it's called The Passion and Purpose Project. And it's about this idea that I do think you have to have passion for what you're doing and you have to have a purpose. Like, I love this community. I love giving back to this community. I genuinely enjoy, you know, seeing a group of employees that are happy. This is genuine for me. So it wasn't like I wanted another job or, you know, motivated by money. It was just more motivated by being part of the community. And, you know, not that I don't want to be successful. Obviously, every business, you want to be financially successful. But to me, it's more about what we're building and our relation, how we're building it and the way we're operating in the community that is my passion. So I think you've got to be genuine about those things. Yeah. And you also really have to know your why. You know, people mm-hmm. can smell fake a mile away.
mm-hmm. And you're not fake at all. You've never, from the day I met you, I was like, well, first of all, you're from Ohio. We're both from Ohio. So
Midwestern.
I was like, she's a good egg. You know, when you talk about going to these events and giving back to our community, is it true that Woodhouse never says no? I mean, you guys are always donating gift cards and prize packages for auctions. I know we're not in an event phase right now with COVID, but you just do incredible. Do you have any idea how much you've given to this community? Do you track that?
You know, I really should have kept track. I really haven't kept track. But from the very beginning, I wanted us to have 100% yes policy. So our policy is 100% yes to all nonprofits. So, and that comes in the form of, you know, our charity or hospitality gift cards. And those gift cards do, you know, have some restrictions on them. But in order for me to give back at that level, you know, and we want people to come into the spa, right? So we want to give back to the community, but we also want to make sure people come in and see what we're doing and enjoy what we're doing. So there is a give and take with those, but it's very important to me because I feel like, you know, I don't know. I just feel like when you own a business in a community, you should be part of the community.
Yeah. And you do a great job at that for sure. You know, we always see the polished Kim Powell at these events, Kim Powell working, Kim Powell networking. I want to know the real Kim Powell. Like, what is your day like? I've seen your TikToks dancing with the family. You have a fun side.
I really shouldn't talk about those TikToks. A lot of people, we only have four followers.
Are you an early riser? Do you turn off at some point at night and then decide, you know, you're going to pour a glass of wine and have some fun with the kids? You know, kind of what does your day look like?
Okay, so this is the cold, hard truth. I do not set an alarm ever. Almost never. If I have to get on an airplane, maybe. But my husband will say, when are you getting up? I say, oh, when the good Lord wakes me. So I don't ever, ever set an alarm. I don't make any morning appointments. I don't do lunches. I don't do coffee. I will take a walk with someone if they want to meet. I ask for an email first because my time is very valuable to me and my sanity. So I never drink at home or during the weekday, with the exception if I'm out socially. So you do see me with a glass of champagne, but the irony is I never drink at home because it interrupts my ability to sleep. But in this city, there's like events, like I have to go to something tonight at 5:30. I'm like, ah, man. But so I will have a cocktail socially. I work almost every night. I work like, and when I get home around 5 or 6 o'clock, I'll sit and I'll return emails till about 8 or 9 o'clock. And I don't ever really turn off. I wake up at 3 in the morning and start working sometimes for thinking about stuff, but it's all stuff I really just enjoy doing.
Right.
But I am extremely private and I don't really spend, I work from home mm-hmm. and I now commute between Fripp Island and downtown Charleston. Mm-hmm. So I'm not in the spas as much as I used to be, but I like that because I can think and work more on the spas and be more efficient.
Right. You know, you're running spas and talking about obviously self-care for other people. What kind of self-care do you allow yourself? Because it sounds like you're always working, even though you enjoy it. You know, do you have those moments where you give yourself some daytime or you allow yourself to go in for one of your own treatments?
Yes. In fact, most of the time now I am going into the spa for a service and I do that for a couple of reasons. One, I get to enjoy the service, but two, I get to really see how the spa is operating. I get to look and see and hear what's going on in the spa and talk to guests. So I actually do go into the spa and that's pretty much now. And then sometimes my managers or people come sit with me in the relaxation, we'll catch up on business. And so it is. It's kind of nice. And it's nice for them too, because they can step away from the desk and come sit with me and we can just chat about things. So I do get to go in and I really do guard my privacy very, very much. If you know, we get a lot of those, can I just have 5 minutes of your time? And I am really, really strict about saying honestly no, but please send me an email and I'll look at it in the evening, research all of it and get back to you if I am interested. Because you can't say yes to all those meetings and things, or you just would never, I don't know what I would do.
So what I hear you saying, and this is great advice, when you are so busy, all the people that want COVID or meetings, you really try to cut that down and kind of filter that first because you have limited times, especially in the morning hours.
Yes, yes. I don't usually take any calls in the morning at all. I usually go for a long walk or a bike ride. But I have someone, you know, usually at the spa, someone who handles the events, someone who handles the charities, someone who handles the party requests, so that all that communication, you know, is filtered and we get back to people really in a timely way. But yeah, I think the best advice is you have to guard your time. You cannot say yes to everything or you will be exhausted and you don't feel like you're getting You know, we're such multitaskers in this country. Mm-hmm. And multitasking is just another word for not doing anything well, really. I mean, and I'm totally guilty of this. I am legit the guiltiest person ever. But in my mind, I realize, like, I'm not doing, if I'm this and this, and I'm like, I'm doing nothing well. And I don't want to be that. I want to be present. So I'm really trying to focus on that this year and really stay present in what I'm doing and allow space for that without saying, you know, trying to do 10 things at once.
Right. I have two more questions for you before we go. Number one, as a spa owner, I'm sure lots of people ask you, but what do you do for your skin? Because you have access to all the good stuff. And then I want to finish with your book. I know you're in the process of writing it, but when will it come out and when and where can we get it?
Okay. So first, what do I do for my skin? I don't do as much as I should, but I do go to the spa and get hydrofacials regularly, which I love. I use SkinCeutical products, which I've had to baby step into because my skin will react. I have light skin. And so I'm now converting over to all these awesome SkinCeutical products that people have been telling me how great they are for so many years. And so I'm just now becoming, you know, really into regular routine with those. Right. So I do that. And then I use my Jane Ardell makeup in Charleston, and I'm using our Vapor makeup down at Fripp Island. Oh. So I'm trying to use the downtown all natural line, location, which is a little more, I don't put on as much makeup. And here I'm trying to use our Jane line. So I'm kind of just, you know, trying to make sure I always am using what I'm selling, because I want to make sure that we're always selling the best products for our clients.
Right. That's great to hear. And then last, of course, your book.
Yeah, so I've been working on this book for about 2 years, and unfortunately, between opening the second spa, the beef jerky experience, and also
we haven't even talked about that. You have another store.
That's all right. Moving and a bunch of other stuff. I just wasn't able to focus on it. So the book is called The Passion and Purpose Project. I'm actually very passionate about this book, and I'm excited about it. And we're just in the final stages of finishing it. So I think it'll be coming out in May, I'm hoping.
Wow. I thought the working process was going to be longer than that. May's right around the corner. That's great.
Yeah, we've been working on it for quite a while. And what it's about is basically I take the reader through something called your future funnel, which is a process I created, which kind of takes you through what you like, what you don't like, what your passions are, what your purpose is, and what you want your legacy to be for your children and for your life.
Wow.
And you kind of go through this funnel. And hopefully when you get to the bottom of the funnel or the end of the book, you kind of have a little better idea of what you're willing to sacrifice, how much time you're willing to spend, and what you truly want versus what you think you might want.
All right. I can't wait. And it'll be where all books are sold. I mean, I'm sure we'll hear about it when it comes out.
Yes. We will launch on Amazon, but I don't really know anything past that, but I will keep you posted.
Is there anything before we go? Anything? I mean, I could talk to you for hours, but is there anything that I didn't touch on? Anything you want our listeners to know? Any last tips?
No, I think just at the end of the day, we just need to do a better job of believing in ourselves and taking those leaps. You know, just like I said, you've done many of those things, and it is so scary. And you think everybody else makes it look so easy because you don't see all the journey getting there, right? And so we all have sadness and happiness and struggles and strife and failures and worries and insecurities. We're all the same. Everybody's the same. And so you just have to take one step closer each day to doing what you truly want to do.
All right, Kim, on that, I'm going to let us finish that beautiful words that you just said. Thank you for your time today. Thank you. Kim Powell, Woodhouse Day Spa in Mount Pleasant and downtown. Kim, the best way to book is just go to the website.
Yes. Oh, always. Yes. Go to the website or call the spa. And we actually have two new texting lines, which are awesome. So now you can text to get your appointments, which is great.
All right. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you. You've been listening to the Voice of Charleston Women podcast with Kim Powell.
Bye.
Thanks for spending time with Voice of Charleston Women podcast. Please like us and follow us on whatever platform you're using to access Voice of Charleston Women.